Ascent Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Stories for Work, The Essential Guide to Business Storytelling by Gabrielle Dolan, narrated by Brigid, Lohrey. Disclaimer: the material in this publication is of the nature of general comment only and does not represent professional advice. It is not intended to provide specific guidance for particular circumstances, and it should not be relied on as the basis for any decision to take action or not take action on any matter which it covers. Readers should obtain professional advice where appropriate before making any such decision. To the maximum extent permitted by law, the author and publisher disclaim all responsibility and liability to any person arising directly or indirectly from any person taking or not taking action based on the information in this publication. Introduction. I once had the pleasure of working with a wonderful woman, Merrin Butler, who confessed to sleeping or reading through the safety instructions on her regular Sunday night flight from Dublin to Glasgow. She told me that catching the same flight every week for work made her understandably very blasé. So she'd either fall asleep or read the paper as the crew pulled on oxygen masks and pointed out the exits. One night, on her regular flight, after giving her usual lack of attention to the pre-flight demonstration, they hit some rough weather and the pilot had to abort the landing as they were coming into Glasgow. The plane circled around and tried again, but the rain and wind were getting worse, and so the pilot abandoned the landing for the second time. Before making the third attempt, the captain announced, "We'll make one final attempt to land, but before we do, the crew will all go through our safety instructions again." All the passengers sat bolt upright in their seats, their undivided attention on the crew. People asked questions about the oxygen masks, checked for their life jackets under their seats, and physically counted out the rows to their nearest exit. Thankfully, Merrin lived to tell the frightening tale, as did everyone else on the plane. When she shared this story with me long after the incident, I was helping her to implement a major organisational change at National Australia Bank. It was going to be a 2-year process that would affect all the human resources professionals across the company. I asked Merrin what was the one message she wanted to get across to her team when we announced the change. She said they'd all be thinking, "Here we go again, another change or restructure." But Merrin felt that it was more than that. Although the change would be a long, intensive project, everyone would receive lots of information about it, and while at the time they might think it was boring or irrelevant, they needed to pay close attention because it was going to personally affect each and every one of them at some point. As the communications and change manager for the project, I suggested she share her story about flying into Glasgow. Her initial reaction was, "What has that got to do with anything?" I convinced Merrin to share the story, however, knowing it matched her message. Often we think information we're receiving may not be relevant, but it does have an important purpose. I was confident the story would work. Well, maybe not confident, but optimistic. The next day, Merrin shared her flight story with her team of HR professionals. I watched and waited for the response in the room. I'll admit, by this stage, the optimism had turned to hope. I should have been confident because this became the first time I really noticed the positive impact of a personal story when delivered as a business message. Not only did her team immediately react with smiles and understanding, but they also continued to refer to the story months later. I wasn't aware of it at the time, but that was a sliding door moment for me. I realized the power of storytelling, and this knowledge completely changed my career and my life. From that point on, I noticed that all the leaders I found inspiring and engaging used stories to explain their actions and choices in some way. I left my corporate career on a mission to change the boring and bland way we communicated in the business world with inspiring and engaging stories that hit the hearts and minds of leaders and their teams. Over the last decade, this work has taken me all over the world, from Australia to Malaysia, Europe, and the US. But no matter where I am, I'm always faced with questions and comments like the following. Does storytelling really work in business? I mean, really? What stories do I need and how many do I use? How do you find stories? I don't have any stories. I just lead a pretty average and normal life. Where and when do you share stories in business? I'd never thought of using a personal story to communicate a business message. Are we allowed to do that? Hearing these kinds of questions and remarks from so many different leaders, managers, and executives at all levels in all industries and corporations all over the world was the catalyst behind this book. My aim is to show you the science behind why storytelling really works, because it does work, as the many examples in this book will show. This book also clarifies what types of stories are appropriate to use, how to find them, and how to share them. What I love most about this book is that it gives you a collection of tried and tested stories from people who have successfully used them in their business lives. I know from my own experience that hearing other people's stories helps to ignite story ideas of your own. My intention is to help you generate your own stories, show you where and when to use them, and most importantly, give you the courage to share your own stories and get great results. So, put down your paper and pay close attention. You're about to fly into the wonderful world of storytelling. Part 1. Shaping your stories. Storytelling has been around since the dawn of time, and humans have always communicated using stories. Evidence of this is seen from the paintings left by our cave-dwelling ancestors to the Aboriginal culture and dreamtime storytelling, which continues to be passed down generation to generation. It's only recently, however, that modern business has started to realise the power and potential of this ancient art. In a world of information overload and short attention spans, business people are looking for a more effective way to get their messages across and to help them stand out from all the noise. Combine this with an appreciation of being more authentic in the way we lead, and it is no surprise that storytelling has emerged as a powerful tool. In this part, I take you through exactly why storytelling is so powerful in business, drilling down into the science behind it. I also cover the four main types of stories you will need, and how to find, construct, and share your stories. While the art of storytelling is an ancient form, the applications of storytelling in business are just being discovered. Chapter 1. The Science of Storytelling. Sure, you might already be aware that telling a story makes good sense, but it is more than that. It is actually based on good science. In this chapter, I take you through this science, explaining how stories build trust and heighten emotions. The brain behind the story. Our brain has different parts, and each part has a different job. The left side of our brain, for example, helps us think logically and organize our thoughts, while the right side helps us experience emotions and recall personal memories. We also have a reptile brain that makes us act instinctively and a mammal brain that helps us connect in relationships. And our brains have a neocortex, which is connected to a complex series of nerves and networks called the limbic system. This is responsible for the development of the bond we feel between ourselves and another, like the mother-child bond. In his international best-selling book, Emotional Intelligence, Daniel Goleman explains that our evolved neocortex is the reason our emotions are so powerful. He says, "As the root from which the newer brain grew, the emotional areas are intertwined via myriad connecting circuits to all parts of the neocortex. This gives the emotional centers immense power to influence the functioning of the rest of the brain." When we tell stories, all the different parts and areas of our brain are stimulated and start to work together, combining words and logic and emotions and sensory images, so we see the whole picture and communicate our experience. Essentially, with all this activity going on, our emotions go into overdrive. This means that stories provoke our emotions. Good stories make us feel something as we listen to them: excitement, anger, sadness, empathy, or enthusiasm. Consequently, feeling these emotions means we feel something towards the person telling the story, which helps create connection, the bond like the ones our neocortex helps develop. We love a good story. In 2014, Harvard Business Review article, "Why Your Brain Loves Good Storytelling," neuroeconomist Paul Zak revealed the powerful impact the love hormone oxytocin has on the brain when we tell stories. Oxytocin is also often referred to as the trust hormone. Our bodies release it when we are with people we love and trust, when we hug, or even when we shake hands in a business meeting. And it's released when we listen to stories. Oxytocin being released signals to the brain that everything is okay and it is safe to approach others. Essentially, that we won't be attacked or eaten, as would have been the risk back in the day. So not only does a good story make us feel different emotions and a connection to the storyteller, but at the same time, the love hormone oxytocin is also signaling that we can be trusted, which in turn helps build our credibility. Stories build trust and credibility. Neuroscientist Yuri Hassan opened his 2016 TED Talk with the following. "Imagine if we invented a device that could record my memories, my dreams, my ideas, and transmit them to your brain. That would be a game-changing technology, right? But in fact, we already possess this device, and it's called the Human Communication System and Effective Storytelling." Hassan's research shows that even across different languages, our brains show similar activity when we hear a story, becoming what he calls aligned or synchronized. In one study, listeners lay in the dark waiting to hear a story spoken out loud. The moment the story started, the auditory cortex of the listener's brains, the area that processes sound, became active and aligned. Hassan calls this neural entrainment. It was only when the listeners heard the story in a coherent way that alignment started to happen. This did not happen if the story was played backwards, or the words or sentences were scrambled. But the story was still understood in a similar way when it was told in Russian to a group of Russian listeners as it was when told in English to a group of English listeners. The participants were also shown a clip from the BBC TV series Sherlock. Months later, one participant was asked to tell another about the scene they watched. The results showed that the brain of the person telling the story aligned with the same activity their brain showed when they watched the show some months earlier. Furthermore, the brain of the participant who was listening to the story also aligned in a similar way. So, what does all this prove? Listening to a story being told is effectively like reliving that story as if it were yours. What better way to create common ground and a shared understanding with someone? And this is especially the case if you're making a presentation to an audience of 1,000 strangers or even facilitating a one-on-one coaching session. Emotions drive our decisions. Just some of the questions running through the minds of our audience when we are talking to them include the following. Do I buy from you? Do I get behind this change? Do I accept the role with you? Do I believe you? Do I take your advice? Do I follow you? Do I respect you? Our audience will be forming these types of questions whether we're trying to get them to buy into an organizational change or motivate them towards next year's goals. Usually, we try to influence them with a PowerPoint presentation of facts and figures, or an outline of the pros and cons of whatever it is we want them to feel excited about. These strategies are all based on logic. Yet, science says that we make up our minds to the types of questions I listed based on our emotions and how we feel about something. Research by neuroscientist Antonio Damasio shows emotion plays a significant role in our ability to make decisions. While many of us believe logic drives our choices, the reality is that we have already made an emotional decision and we then use logic to justify the choice, to ourselves and to others. Damasio's research involved examining people with damage to their frontal lobe, which is the area of the brain where emotions are generated and that helps to regulate personality. Except for their inability to feel or express emotions, the participants had normal intellectual capacity in terms of working memory, attention, language comprehension, and expression. However, they were unable to make decisions. The vast majority of participants could describe in logical terms what they thought they should be doing, but they found it difficult to actually make a decision, including making a simple choice like deciding what to eat. This indecision came from them going over the pros and cons for each option again and again. Presented with a choice to make, we struggle to make a decision without some form of emotion influencing it. Influence and impact. Damasio's research does not stand alone. According to Christine Comerford, neuroscience expert and author of the New York Times bestseller Smart Tribes: How Teams Become Brilliant Together, 90% of human behavior and decision-making is driven by our emotions. Not fully understanding this is often why we get incredibly frustrated when our team members do not do what we want them to do. In our mind, our request makes logical sense. But as best-selling author Dale Carnegie put it, when dealing with people, let us remember we are not dealing with creatures of logic. We are dealing with creatures of emotion. That's why it's important to note the differences between a case study and a story. Case studies are based on logic, facts, and figures. You'll see from those provided in chapters 13 to 15. They still play an important role in business, but not from the standpoint of connecting with someone on an emotional level. Marketing executives and advertisers are acutely aware of the power of using storytelling and emotion in business to drive purchasing decisions. You only have to look at the latest car advert for proof. A study of over 1,400 marketing campaigns submitted to the UK-based Institute of Practitioners in Advertising, IPA, rated how effective marketing campaigns were based on profit gains. The results showed campaigns based purely on emotion rated as 31% effective. Campaigns based purely on logic rated as only 16% effective. Campaigns that combined emotion and logic rated as 26% effective. This research indicates that using logic alone has the least impact, and using emotion has almost double the impact. For more on this research, go to neurosciencemarketing.com/blog and search emotional ads. Storytelling is deeply rooted in making an emotional connection with another person. That's why, if you're looking to make an impact or influence someone at work, it makes scientific sense to use a story. Attention, please! Remember Paul Zak's research on oxytocin and storytelling? His research goes on to show that when we listen to a tense moment in a story, our brains produce the stress hormone cortisol, which helps us to focus. In one of his studies, participants watched an emotional story about a father and his son. Both cortisol and oxytocin were released in varying degrees in the participants. When cortisol was present, the participants with higher amounts of oxytocin also present were more likely to donate money to someone they had never met. The research showed that in order to motivate people to help others, a story must first sustain attention and then develop tension. If this is the case, listeners are more likely to share the emotions of the characters in the story and mimic the feelings and behaviours of those characters. These findings have significant relevance in business. Zak's research shows that character-driven stories that provoke emotion result in a better understanding of key messages in the story. More importantly, listeners are better able to recall the main points weeks later. As Zak states, in terms of making impact, this blows the standard PowerPoint presentation to bits. Remember when? An investigation into autobiographical memories found that emotionally charged events are remembered better. Pleasant emotions are usually remembered better than unpleasant ones. Positive memories contain more contextual details, which in turn helps memory. Strong emotion can impair memory for less emotional events and information experienced at the same time. Emotional arousal, not the importance of the information, helps memory. Anyone who works in business must sit up and take note of these findings, especially that it's emotion, not logical information, that helps us to remember messages. Too many leaders in business believe that having an important message to share, such as the new strategy or technical change, is reason enough for their audience to listen. For more on the preceding findings, go to memory-key.com/memory/emotion. Unfortunately, focusing on logical information usually produces the opposite effect. Without a story or a connection to how this new strategy is going to make listeners feel, the message is usually lost or slept through and forgotten. This is why you should use a story. The safety industry has been decades ahead of the rest of business when it comes to memorable campaigns and messages. In particular, Air New Zealand. The airline is renowned for using humour and storytelling in their in-flight videos to deliver crucial information when it comes to safety in the air. In 2011, the first of these videos was launched, starring American fitness guru Richard Simmons. Fit to Fly shows a bunch of lycra-clad passengers working out as they buckle up and demonstrate putting on their oxygen masks. The video has had over 3 million views on YouTube. Pretty amazing for a boring old safety video. Other Air New Zealand campaigns featured Bear Grylls from Man vs. Wild and Golden Girls actress Betty White. If you haven't seen them, you can find them easily via a quick search on YouTube. Australian airline Qantas is also starting to follow this lead. While they do not use humour like Air New Zealand, they do use stereotypical Australian characters and scenes outside of a plane to deliver the safety messages. You can also find Qantas examples on YouTube. Even Merrin, my friend from the introduction of this book who slept through the airline safety instructions, would agree these unusual videos and stories grab your attention much longer than the stock standard boring ones. So, if you lead a safety meeting as part of your role, or indeed need to impart other kinds of crucial information, this is an opportunity for you to start sharing a story instead of reading out a list of bullet points about compliance with your team. The research in this chapter proves that tapping into emotion not only aids our understanding of a logical message, but also helps us retain that information. We are more likely to remember a good story as opposed to a bunch of facts. As American poet Maya Angelou famously said, "People will forget what you said. People will forget what you did, but people will never forget how you made them feel." Make your stories work. This chapter showed you the science behind storytelling. You learned that stories provoke emotions in our brain and body, stimulate the release of the love hormone oxytocin, make us feel something towards the person telling the story, help build trust and credibility, influence our audience into making a decision, aid in focusing listeners on key messages, help us to remember details rather than just facts and logic alone. So, what stories do you need? Do you need different types of stories? How many of these stories do you need? How long will it take you to find them? We answer these questions in the next chapter. Chapter 2. Four types of stories you need in business. What stories do you need? Do you need different types of stories? How many of these stories do you need? How long will it take to find them? These are all common questions I am often asked. Various authors have suggested the correct number of stories you need is between 6 and 8. Stephen Denning, in The Leader's Guide to Storytelling, for example, explores 8 types of stories. So too does Valerie Koo in Power Stories. In The Story Factor, Annette Simmons points out the 6 types of stories you need to tell in business, while in The 7 Basic Plots, Why We Tell Stories, Christopher Booker outlines 7 basic stories. Though apparently Booker worked on this manuscript for 34 years, which is a long time for 7 stories, and my intention is to help you find stories faster than that. Outlining the 4 story types. The reality is that no right or wrong answer exists to questions about the number or types of stories you need in business. However, I like to keep things simple and efficient, so in my experience, I can say that you only need 4 types of stories in your business story wheel. These are stories of 1. Triumph, 2. Tragedy, 3. Tension, 4. Transition. All 4 types will include a mix of work and non-work related stories. Let's discuss each story type and the different elements within them in more detail. The four types of stories are noted next. Triumph stories. These are stories of achievement, the moments in your career and personal life that you are especially proud of, and looking for a variety of triumphs that are both work and non-work related is important. Firstly, you will need to reflect upon your personal opinion of what a triumph is. Success looks and feels differently to various people. Your personal triumphs might not actually mean you won something. They may mean you had the courage to try. Many of us feel uncomfortable with sharing our triumphs at work for fear of sounding like we are arrogant or boasting. Try to get over this. Sharing these types of stories doesn't have to be about bragging that you got a promotion or ran your first marathon. Focus on how much the experience meant to you personally and why the achievement was so significant. If you demonstrate vulnerability and humility, your story will hit the right note. It's also important to look for stories that show how you have helped others triumph. Maybe you were part of a team that received an award or met its yearly targets. Or perhaps your story of triumph is about coaching your daughter's basketball team when they won the grand final. Or maybe they didn't win a game all year, but every one of them improved. Focus on how this made you feel. Remember, this is about whatever success or triumph looks and feels like for you, and is not just about winning. You should also look for stories that demonstrate when you have helped the wider community. Have you volunteered through your company? Worked on a project that made a difference? Helped out with a children's fundraiser? Or stopped a high-rise development in your street? It's important to have a combination of your own triumphs and those that came from helping others or being part of a team or community. Tragedy stories. These stories vary according to your perspective on what you consider a disaster. Some examples may truly be about tragic circumstances, while others may be stories of regret. Stories of regret may be when you didn't have the courage to do something. This could be going for a promotion or taking that overseas assignment. The regret could be about not asking the love of your life out on a date or feeling like you didn't spend enough time with your parents when they were older. Other tragedy stories might be about things that happened to you through no fault of your own. The loss of a loved one, or the bankruptcy of a company you were working for, perhaps. You need to avoid sounding like a victim, however. Sure, these events had an enormous impact on your life, but make sure you focus on what you learned from the experience as opposed to simply complaining about the circumstances. You may also think of a tragedy story that was caused by you. Perhaps a decision you made that had dire consequences, like making an error while driving that led to a serious accident, or providing advice to someone that in hindsight was incorrect. When it comes to divulging stories, understand that...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.